Good evening and welcome to Creative Current. This is the show where we talk to some of the most fascinating people in Los Angeles about what's going on in the arts and the cultural scene. We have a really interesting guest with us tonight. Well, they're all interesting. But before we get to that, I just wanted to remind you, if you have an opportunity on your computer, just click on sign up for the newsletter. You just go there and you type in your email address and we'll send you information about upcoming shows and give you incredible opportunities for discounts at some of the coolest downtown restaurants and bars. So tonight, our guest is Hassan Said. Did I say that
yeah.
about right?
Yeah.
Oh, great. And Hassan is a young filmmaker who comes from Egypt originally, studied also in New York and in San Francisco. And recently he produced a film in Africa, I always want to say Angola, but actually, no, it is Angola.
It is Angola.
And it's a very interesting film. How did you get involved with that? And tell us a little bit about that.
Well, the whole story started, I had a friend of mine, a colleague, Mario Bastos. He's originally from Angola, and he saw some of the work that I did, and he wanted to work with me in producing a film in Africa. So a year and a half before we shot, we finessed the script. We got it all ready to go, and then we started scouting and putting it in budget and getting people.
Now, I mean, it must be fascinating shooting in Angola because you don't think about the Angolan film industry.
Yeah.
So there must have been some real challenges there.
Absolutely. I mean, Angola is one of those places like you can't, like in LA or in San Francisco, go to a rental house and get a lens or get a light or a prop if you need it. You know, I mean, it's raw. There's like three filmmakers in the whole country. There's not really a strong film society there.
Right.
But I think doing the film there really helped a lot. It got a lot of attention there. It was fun.
And this film is beautifully shot. And I got to say, there's just some incredible moments in it. And it's a very interesting film. It's about, and what's interesting, one of the most challenging things about it that you look at and you go, oh, my God. It's about corruption on a local level.
Yeah.
It's about intimate relationships. It's about how this couple is engaged, and he's bringing a dowry to her.
Yes.
He gets involved in an accident, and then things take off from there. I don't want to give it away. What must it have been like to shoot with the police there? And the
it was challenging because like we had to get our police uniforms and our police car from the police,
right.
And we were waiting and waiting for weeks to hear back from them. We got the approval like the night before the day that we shot because there's not really a lot of resources there to just give a car for a film shoot.
Right.
But it was fun because a lot of times when we were shooting, they would take the car and just go because they had to do their own thing and
yeah.
we'd have to wait for them.
Well, I mean, the heart of the movie is about, you know, about people's hearts and
yeah.
human goodness and prevailing and over challenging
Absolutely.
Situations. But there's a little message there about local corruption.
Yeah.
And did you run into any problems with the local authorities in terms of the subject matter?
No, they were actually very, very accommodating, even though the script does clearly have a main antagonist who is a bad cop. They mm-hmm. were really actually very helpful, and they brought people to help us on set. They were very accommodating to the story of a man and a woman trying to get married in a very, very difficult time.
Well, we have a clip that's coming. Do you know what's in this clip?
I think
this
so.
This is the one you sent to us.
Yeah, it's a clip where Matthias pretty much gets taken away by the cop and they take his dowry away from him. Yeah.
Yeah, let's take a look.
Vai buscar a viatura e tudo que tem lá dentro. Aposto que é roubado.
Thank you. I mean, great cinematography.
Thank you.
And some really great acting. And I'm guessing that not all of those people are professional actors.
No, I mean, they're mostly, some of them are theatrically trained, but none of them have actually, a lot of them haven't really worked in film ever before. So it's a whole new experience for them.
And this location, this isn't some studio set.
No, we shot in Luanda. We shot in a neighborhood called Ilha de Luanda. It's one of the shanty town areas, and we're actually going to shoot on the beach in one of the shanty towns, but like a flood came and it wiped out the whole town off the beach.
God.
So we had to change location like in months before we were shooting. Yeah.
And what was that location like? Were the people welcoming? Were they interested in what you were doing?
Absolutely. Like they were there. They were supporting us. They were watching. If we needed extras and people to come help us out, they would just come and they'd be very excited. And you feel like you were affecting these people in a very positive way and exciting them about something that really is part of their life, shooting in their own home. Yeah.
Now this is a short film, and the director is Angolan,
yeah,
which
Mario.
Is interesting because I didn't think there was much of an Angolan film industry.
Yeah.
But you studied with him in San Francisco.
Yeah, me and Mario Bastos, we studied together in the Academy of Art. Yeah.
Is there starting to be a developing film industry in Africa among these young independent filmmakers like Mario?
I think so. I mean the things are working out really well. Like Mario's working on a documentary right now, and we're trying to shoot a feature in the next couple of years. So we're trying to revive and get people's attention to help and support films in Africa, because Africa is pretty much the most beautiful place you could ever be to shoot a film.
I'm sure. And so what else about filming in Angola itself? I mean, it certainly logistically, it couldn't have been the easiest place.
No, I mean, there's a lot of problems. I mean, of course, language barriers is one of them.
Right. Oh, yeah, and you're speaking some strange foreign tongue in this film.
Portuguese. Yeah, and I mean, most of the crew hasn't really worked on a film set, and they don't know what a film etiquette, like what set etiquette is like, and
right.
who to talk to when you need something, and teaching people about that was interesting, and them learning and absorbing it. And yeah, we taught like 20 something people how to work on a set in
cool.
like a matter of weeks. Yeah.
Well, hopefully those people they'll be up more production in that.
Absolutely.
Did you get a sense that what you were doing had an impact in terms of?
Yeah, our special effects artist that she got hired actually for a job for one of the camera rental places that we use. So they used her special effects work after they saw the footage to give her more work, so that was a huge positive thing that we're really happy about.
One of the things that you notice in this film is that it's really about intimate human relationships, and it's really about strong emotions. And this seems to be a theme of yours in your earlier work as well.
Yeah.
And I know you just finished a film, Mute.
Yes.
And that did very well in Germany, won some awards.
Yeah, it got into about 10 festivals. It won an award in Oldenburg International Film Festival in Germany, and it was a sold-out show. It was a lot of fun.
And it's a really challenging subject. This is about a father who discovers his autistic wife, or his autistic daughter, has been abused.
Yes.
And can we take a look at this clip? I think it's one of the more powerful clips. Oh, yeah.
Sensual, Anna. Think about the bowl of fruit you drew with the strawberries and the grapes. That's it, beautiful. Beautiful, hold it. These turned out really well, Anna. Why don't you take a look? This button right here. And use this to look through them. Go ahead, give it a try. Isn't that one beautiful?
interesting stuff. Very challenging subject matter. How did you come to this subject?
Well, the original idea originated because I was reading a lot of news about parents essentially killing their children, and I thought it's something that it's not really tackled a lot in movies where you see a father or a mother having to go as far as killing their own child. And I wrote a 3-page script about this whole story, and I started, you know, it was really hard to find actors to act in it and want to commit to something that was essentially very extreme in subject matter. But it's all about, you know, trying to relate a father who is desperate and help survive with his daughter in the current world and being protective of her and how he protects her. And
it's interesting because it's actually a subject that is probably better known in Europe than it is here, where there are extreme cultural differences. I know, for instance, in Germany, where there's a Gastarbeiter population, a lot of Turkish families where honor killings are something that's a little more frequent here. And this isn't so much about that as it is about angst. And I mean, how would you describe this?
It's about being pushed off the edge. It's about living one day in your life and everything that could possibly go wrong would go wrong. But in the end of the day, how do you fix it? Do you fix it in a way that is actually right for you and for your family, or do you actually go the other route because you really do see no other right but that? You know, it's pushing yourself to the edge and trying to save yourself or the person with you before you completely collapse. That's what Mute is really like about.
It's interesting that because I actually see a relationship between that and the next film that I want to talk about, because it's about extreme emotions. It's about being put into an intolerable situation. And I think the film of yours that moved me the most, I mean, when I saw it, our director and producer, Mark, I called him in and said, "My God, you've got to see this thing," because it's about a trauma that every American is familiar with, the bombing of the World Trade Center.
Yes.
And yet it's a very short, very abstract piece.
Yes.
And actually, I think because we have a lot to talk about this piece, I think it's better if we can just look at this piece first and then talk a little bit about how it's put together. And
you know, MSNBC has just flashed on my screen. It looks like there is a plane that's crashed into the World Trade Center.
We got Warner on the phone who's looking at it right now.
Warner?
You can see the fire. You can see the smoke. I mean, it's a monster hole. You know, the World Trade Center, the Twin Towers, it's the one on the right. And it is...
This just in, you are looking at obviously a very disturbing live shot there. That is the World Trade Center, and we have unconfirmed reports this morning that a plane
we want to tell you what we know as we know. We just got a report in that there's been some sort of explosion at the World Trade Center in New York City.
Okay, I have got to interrupt you right now. Just a moment. First, this is today on NBC.
As Matt just mentioned, we have a breaking news story to tell you about. Apparently, a plane has just crashed into the World Trade Center.
This is a breaking news story, a serious news story. A plane has crashed into the World Trade Center.
This just into our newsroom, a plane has crashed into the World Trade Center.
Oh my God. That looks like a second plane.
Oh, another one just hit. Something else just hit. A very large plane just flew directly over my building, and there's been another collision. Can you see it?
Yes.
I can see it on the shot.
Oh my.
Something else has just hit. We just
saw. So you have no idea where right now.
Oh, there's another one. Another plane just hit.
The wing just had to be at least 150 to 200 feet.
Right. Oh my God. Oh. The next building is just blew up. Oh my God. The second tower has exploded from about the 20 stories below in a gargantuan explosion.
We just saw another one. Just saw another one apparently go Another plane just flew into the second tower. This raises... This has to be deliberate, folks.
...that also appears to range over maybe 15 to 20 stories at the least. Some sort of secondary explosion in the other tower.
That's the second building, so...
Reports of a plane hijacking before these crashes we're telling you about at the World Trade Center towers this morning.
Secondary explosion within those planes.
Thanks very much.
Necessary or possible
side was collapsing.
And we will all absolutely never forget. This was our day of infamy. This was our Pearl Harbor. It was just...
It gives me chills to look at it still. And I've seen that, I think I've seen it now four or five times. The remarkable thing about it is that we're all familiar with that, all that audio. The fact that all the visuals are abstract, because it seems to be an expression of anxiety and fear and the chaos of the moment that we all went through while we were watching that. And it seems to communicate it so well and compresses what was, you know, several hours experience into a very short period of time. And we were talking earlier, and I asked you, I said, well, you must have cut the video to the audio, but it was the other way around. I was astounded. Can you explain the process?
Well, the whole process, it took me like about 2 weeks. I started getting clear film, and I started developing this idea that I wanted to do something about September 11th, just because it's such an event that is impactful to me and to other Americans, and actually to other countries in the world. Like, it affected the whole world in a very drastic way. And the only thing I could remember is how claustrophobic everybody felt during these weeks past the event. And the way I did it is, like, I started cutting the visuals together, and then I started thinking about, okay, so what do I want to do for audio? So I started researching, getting, like, New York Fire Department audio records that they had, and, like, news broadcast, Howard Stern.
And all the stuff was on the internet. You found this audio on the internet.
Yeah.
Amazing.
And then I did a sound design based on the image, and I kept tweaking the sound design based on the image.
Yeah.
The image led the way. And then
the image
sound.
Led the way.
Yeah.
I would have thought it would have been exactly the opposite.
Yeah.
But you were balancing them both.
Yes, absolutely.
Because they're so well, it seems to me they're so well integrated. It's almost like a work of music.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, it is. I mean, it's totally edited for the visuals, and it has to go hand in hand. Like, even with the explosions, you see, like, little rubbles and dust and bleached film, and it all...
Yeah, I noticed you've got some painting on film.
You've got
What else did you do? What other parts of the physical process? Because I find it fascinating.
I shot, I hand-processed, I bleached, I burned film, I put tobacco on film, I put paint, acrylic oil, I used grease, I used all kinds of... I scratched negatives, I on everything you could think of to
amazing.
Manipulate it, yeah.
That's an amazing piece. Yeah. And then how did you process it? I mean, was it?
It wasn't a process. Like, some of the reels that I cut in were shots that I did and I hand-developed myself, but
right.
Most of it was, like, me pretty much getting a magnifying glass and a movie reel and cutting on a flatbed and just manually doing the whole thing.
With a razor blade.
Yeah, with a razor blade and a magnifying glass. Yeah.
That's the way films used to be made, by God.
Yeah.
With a razor blade and a magnifying glass.
Exactly.
Well, it's a remarkable piece of work, and it's a very moving piece of work. And it's one of the few films about 9/11 that I think is a truly honest thing, maybe because it's so short. You don't have an opportunity to dramatize the events or to play to a bit of emotion. It's just there. And I think it's a remarkable. How have people reacted to it?
People were, like, first time we screened it, we screened it at the Epidemic Film Festival at the Castro Theater in San Francisco.
The Epidemic Film Festival,
At Castro Theater in San Francisco, and it played on the big screen, and everybody was just so quiet, and there were, like, a lot of sighs, and people were, like, really shaken by it.
Yeah.
Which was really good to see, because that was, the whole point is to see an experience, not to think politically about it, or to kind of wonder too much about it, but just to experience the event, pretty much the whole 9/11 experience in the matter of 4 minutes. And I think it was very effective, hopefully.
Well, it's remarkable because an event like that transcends politics. And I think that that the film, in a sense, captures the moment more than anything else I've ever seen. And I think because of the abstraction, though I'm not sure I understand why.
Because it's such a distorted experience. I mean, when you try to think of this event, like, and you see people talking about it on TV, you're getting pulled in 20 million directions, and visually speaking too, like different angles of cameras, different shots of the building. Like for this, the way I did the World Trade Center is I got Super 8 film that I cut in half and I just taped it so it made it look like the building with the windows. But it's just, it's such a distorted event, and it freaked everybody out so bad that this is the only way I could visualize it. Like,
In a way, the abstract images trigger memories of the images that you saw, you know, that we all saw on TV.
The colors. Too.
Yeah, the colors. Yeah. And it's a remarkable mnemonic thing. Now we're getting towards the end of the show. We want to talk about something completely different.
Okay.
So tell us about Once Upon a Time.
Wow. Once Upon a Time is a film that I shot, was one of my first films that I ever shot on film. It was 16mm. I wanted to do a fantastical love story, but pays homage to like old German expressionistic movies, and like Little Red Riding Hood. So I wrote this story, this crazy story about a guy who is a wolf, and essentially he falls in love with a girl, and when she makes love to him, he transcends and becomes a human being.
Well, it's funny you should say it, because there's a German expressionist quality to it that's quite striking.
Yeah, and it's very noirish too. So it was such a fun project, because we didn't have like a lot of gear, and we just like had fun doing it and playing around and experimenting and building fake trees. And
well, let's take a look. This is just great fun.
Yeah,
I mean, you see a little bit of the old Universal creature movies, some of the great sort of French. We were talking about one of my favorite films, the Beauty and the Beast.
Yeah.
Who was the director? It was not Claude Chabrol. I know. Oh, wait a minute. Was it Jean Renoir?
Jean Renoir. I think so.
Bell.
Yeah.
Great movie. Great movie.
Great costume.
But yes, tell us a little bit about this.
So yeah, I mean, it's just I wanted to tell a love story as bizarre as it could be, and it was the whole idea of trying to use every special effects that we can to make something old and cinematic and classical, like the old movies that we used to watch when we were kids. And we went really, really, really in depth with it, and we manipulated the images so much in the lighting and made it so over the top. It was fun. There's a lot of
she was good too.
She was great, Becky. Yeah, Becky Wang. She was a great actress.
But yeah, I love the sort of German expressionistic quality, the sort of French New Wave thing. It's all there.
Yeah.
And clearly, everybody had a good time.
Yeah, they did. Piece. It was fun. Yeah.
Well, before we go, I want to wrap up this one piece, really nice piece you made, which was kind of a one of these promo things. I don't know. Is it almost like a challenge to do a message piece? Was that what this
Absolutely.
Was?
Absolutely. I mean, we want the thing is, No War is something that it's not really a commercial, and it's technically a PSA. What me and my cinematographer Jordan wanted to do is to do something to voice to kind of show the importance of voting and the fact that the war in Iraq was dragging for so long, and we wanted to show a perspective of a mother losing her child, and we said, well, let's shoot it like a commercial, essentially like a PSA, and we shot it totally different from anything else that I ever shot, like very clean 35mm dollies, and it was so much fun. Like the actors had a blast.
Yeah, let's take a look.
Hello, ma'am. Are you Miss Jacobs?
Yes, I am.
The Secretary of the Army has asked me to express his deep regret that your son...
When a country loses a soldier, life moves on. When a mother loses a son, life stops.
Well done.
Thank you.
Well, we're just about out of time, but it's really a pleasure talking to you.
Thank you.
I know you're in Los Angeles now.
Yes.
The film industry is ready for you.
Let's hit it. Let's hit it.
And I know that in December we're going to be showing a couple of your short films at the Arts District Community Winter Fest coming up on December 10th and 11th. And it's been really, really interesting talking to you. And Alambamento, how can people look at this stuff? Do you have a website?
Yes, we have alambamento.com. If anybody wants to show, like, there's behind-the-scenes footage and photos and everything. If you guys want to donate to help support the cause to send it to more screenings elsewhere in the world, please email us. Our information's on there. And we're screening next in San Francisco, and hopefully we'll wait till December to see what the other festivals
are. And to promote more filmmaking in Africa.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Yes.
Terrific. Well, thanks again. So we're just about out of time, and we'll see you next week here on Creative Current. And so we can wave goodbye now. Goodbye. Wave slowly. Goodbye.